Okay. Hi, everybody. Thanks for suggesting that we do this. And I saw the questions that were submitted earlier, so I'll start with those. This is a topic that I've been researching and publishing on for almost a decade. And so I have a tendency to go off into different digressions. And as a way of disciplining myself, I've written down some notes for how I might briefly respond to each of the questions. And I'll start with those. And then I might add some side thoughts, and also we'll have time for questions and follow up afterwards. So the first question that I looked at was one that just asks about terminology. And this is an important starting place, I guess, because I'll be referring to various practices throughout this live stream. And so clarifying why I use certain language is probably a good place to start. So this question says, what should the procedure or these procedures be called? Circumcision or genital cutting or genital mutilation? What is it that decides what term should be used in a given case? Is it the sex of the person that's affected? Is it the specific type of procedure? Is it the cultural context or something else? So this is an enormous, complicated and very, very politicized question, but I'm going to simplify as much as possible and just tell you what my perspective is. So, generally speaking, I think it should be up to each person to decide whether they view their own body as mutilated or disfigured, especially as this can be very bad for a person's body image and self-esteem, and it can affect their ability to have positive sexual relationships. And to take what in somebody's culture or community is considered normal or even aesthetically preferable, and suddenly to tell them that their personal anatomy is ugly and damaged and disfigured is something that's certainly not a neutral act. It's not merely a scientific description or something like that. The reason why I say that is that the term mutilation specifically signals a change to the body that the speaker regards as bad. And you can see this by considering the example of cosmetic labiaplasty, which is trimming of the labia of the vulva, which is the common procedure in Western countries. So I'll start with this just to get our intuitions oriented around a practice that's maybe more culturally familiar. So to use the definition of the World Health Organization, what they refer to as female genital mutilation, they've defined as simply any cutting of healthy female genital tissue that's not medically necessary. That's their definition. So on this definition, labiaplasty, which is done for cosmetic reasons as opposed to a strictly physical or functional reason, is technically mutilation, female genital mutilation on their view. Now, the World Health Organization doesn't treat it that way. International human rights law doesn't treat it that way. So immediately you have a sense that there's something a little bit more complicated going on than the typical picture. So why do we not refer to labiaplasty as labial mutilation, even though that's what we should call it if we're taking the WHO definition seriously? I think we don't do this because most people recognize that the women who have this procedure done regard the change as an improvement to their body, even if it's based on problematic norms that cause women to feel uncomfortable with their body as it is. That's very well the case and is an important consideration. But nevertheless, all things considered, we accept that from the perspective of the person who chooses this procedure, they regard it as an improvement to their body, not as something that disfigures them. So here, I think we are able to assume that because the woman consents to the procedure. And so the consent here is used as a proxy for a positive attitude. The idea is because she consented, she must see this as a good thing. She must see this as a change that she prefers. But I think consent is really just a proxy here because it's, of course, possible to see a change to your body that was not chosen as an improvement, especially if you've been culturally conditioned to see the change as normal or common. So you might consider something like infant ear piercing or maybe cosmetic orthodontia, some sort of change to the teeth. In any cultural environment where you make a change to a child's body, it's possible that they may grow up to feel that what happened to them was a diminishment, was something that they don't prefer. In which case, I think they have every right to call it a mutilation. But it's possible they may grow up to feel, even as an adaptive preference, that it's something that they like. In which case, for me to override their judgment about their own body and say, well, I'm sorry, you're just wrong. This is an undesirable change, to me, feels a little bit presumptuous. So my own view is that these kinds of body alterations from a moral perspective, should be chosen. The role of consent is to distinguish between the morally acceptable body alterations and the ones that are morally unacceptable. So that's a question of right or wrong, but that's a different question from what's the meaning of the words that we're using, or what's the political significance of the words that we're using. And so my view is, if somebody has a change happen to their body that they regard as good, even if they are just forming an adaptive preference for something they cannot change, I don't feel, from my perspective as a bioethicist who's trying to build bridges with people, that it's my position to tell them that actually their body is ugly and damaged and bad. So in my own work, I use the term genital cutting, and I let each person decide for themselves how they feel or how they want to describe their own body.